All right, back in 1967, FM 100 became the first station in the South to start playing rock and roll on the FM dial.
And when they did, they changed radio in Memphis and America forever. John Scott and Mike Powell are two of those original disc jockeys. They are back in Memphis, Tennessee this weekend celebrating, get this, 50 years of FM 100.
Good to have you here.
Good to be here.
Just to start off with, before we get into the history of it, just being back here for this, John, what does this mean for you?
Oh my gosh, it's everything. It's something I never imagined would happen, and it's just a dream come true for all of us to get together, all the DJs and fans coming out to Lafayette's.
We're going to put the event information on the screen for you.
We began, we had no idea what was going to happen.
I was going to say, you didn't know you were making history, did you?
No, not really. Of course, I'd been in radio for several years prior to joining FM 100, and I was told by some of my old friends, "Man, that's never going to happen." I won't name names. It's just not going to happen. And of course, it was kind of catch can at first, and trying to figure out exactly what we wanted to do, how we wanted to do it.
Right.
The really only stations ahead of us for us. Rock on FM was probably WOR-FM in New York, and there was a station in San Francisco.
And when we're talking rock, give people some perspective. What was playing on the radio at that time?
Well, in 67, a lot of bubblegum music was playing.
Yeah. Okay.
Monkees, 1910 Fruit Gum Company. And when we came on the air, we were lucky enough to get into the age of music with the Moody Blues, Procol Harum, Jimi Hendrix.
Well, I got to ask you, and there's an interesting story here for those who don't know. There was one song, though, that changed everything.
Pretty much.
What was that song, and what was the reaction you got?
Well, it was the Star Spangled Banner by Jimi Hendrix from the Live from Woodstock.
We should never forget that day.
I played it about 3 in the afternoon, and usually when the Star Spangled Banner is played, the engineer at the transmitter thinks we're signing off the air. And so he called the general manager, and I think a sponsor called at the same time going, "You have no idea what these guys are playing. This is a freaky version of
a freaky version.
Hendrix thing is
disrespectful."
Dean Osmond, the general manager, came running into the control room, his veins bulging. "What are you playing?" And I said, "Well, it's a nice version of the Star Spangled Banner." And he said, "Take it off now." I mean, like, I said, "Pick up the turntable? And pick up the needle?" "Yes, pick up the needle."
In mid-song.
Mid-song. "What do you want me to do now?" "Play the Monkees." And so
John played.
We played the Monkees for about 2 days straight.
Wow. But what was the fan reaction, though, from listeners?
Basically, I guess it was maybe a day or two later, a group gathered outside the station at 1960 Union Avenue, and, their little post, what do you call them, placards and everything, bring our music back and so forth and so on. And, I don't know, probably 100 folks maybe out there.
A protest march.
Yeah, protest. And it was spontaneous. It was not, we didn't rig it at all. So Dean called me in, that was the program director, said, "Mike, I need you to go out there and talk to those folks." And I said, "Well, what do you want me to say?" "Just go talk to them." I didn't go out. I'm sorry, I didn't. But it was shortly thereafter that things collapsed.
Well, the ratings at about that time came in, and we had shown a 300% increase in ratings.
People liked what you were playing.
That's what we were doing, because nobody else was doing it.
Yeah. Talk to us why this was also not only monumental for the city of Memphis, but America as a whole during this time period.
Well, because we all loved music, and we were all friends, and we looked for artists that nobody else was playing. And we found David Bowie, and we found Billy Joel, and we found Elton John, and
even Barry Manilow to some degree.
Now he's more on the Monkees genre, but
he wasn't considered that at that time.
Yeah. So really?
Well, he did a concert here. He opened for Bette Midler.
Oh, okay. All right.
And he had the long cut called "Would It Be Magic" or something like that.
So he was 80s.
And we like long cuts. So we
went on about 10, 15 minutes. To play David Bowie?
Yes. I was the first. I did the first interview with David Bowie in America.
Wow.
Yeah.
There's an hour-long
interview. There's about 5 minutes up on YouTube right now. We can't find the rest of the tape, But we were the first station to play David Bowie in America. We were the first station to have an interview with him in America.
Was there one thing in particular about David Bowie's interview that really just kind of stands out?
Yeah, we knew a lot about him, and we said, "How's your wife Angie?" And he goes, "How do you know my wife Angie?" And we knew all about him. We studied him and loved him. And then we said, "Well, how's your kid Zoe?" He went, "How do you know my kid?" And then we asked him about songs that he had in the can, and he went to his wife, he said, "These guys know what we have in the can, songs in the can. How do you know these things?" And we just, we were music fanatics.
And of course, this is long before the internet ever came about. A lot of us do our research.
Yeah. So we were music fanatics. We looked for good music to play, and our audience appreciated that.
It's really hard to believe that this was cutting edge at the time. Mm-hmm. I mean, you hear David Bowie, one of the greatest.
You, of course, have to remember, there weren't that many FM radios when we first went on the air. But the following Christmas, we went on the air in February, following Christmas, sales of FM radio shot up in Memphis. So that was a good indication we were getting somewhere.
Okay.
We've mentioned a few names. What about Tom Petty?
Tom Petty, well, after I left radio, I went to work for MCA Records. And I championed a guy named Johnny. I worked with Pete Townsend of The Who and Skynyrd and Elton John. But I championed this kid named Johnny Cougar. And the company hated him. I loved him. I thought he was a superstar, and they fired me for liking Johnny Cougar, who is now John Mellencamp.
John Cougar Mellencamp.
So I went to work for ABC Records, and I just happened to be looking through some old records, and there was a white jacket sitting there, and I put it on the turntable, not knowing who it was, and it blew my mind, the music. So I went to my boss, and I said, "Who are these guys?" He said, "Oh, that's Tom Petty. We're dropping him from the label. They've record's been out for 8 months. Just forget about it." And I went, "Forget about it? American Girl Breakdown, are you kidding me?" And so I literally got on my knees and said, "Give me 6 weeks to promote this guy." He said, "John, it's an 8-month-old record." I said, "I don't care."
But you got it. You got it played.
I got it played, and the rest is history.
Now, we do have some pictures we want to share with you guys.
Just to take you
back. If you look at the monitors right there, do those bring back a few memories?
Oh, yeah.
All right, so which ones are you?
Well, that's Dean Osmondson on the left.
He was the general manager who said, "Stop playing, play the Monkees."
The general manager said, "Let's rock it."
Okay.
And that was not champagne we were using. He didn't. I'm next. That's myself and David Day, who's no longer with us, unfortunately. And
Ron Michaels.
Greg Hamilton.
What do you think of radio today?
Well, I think it'll never be the same as we had it. Okay. There's one person telling 50 stations what to play.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
You can go to one town, to one town, to one town, and hear the same thing.
All sounds
good. We appreciate what you gentlemen have done, and
thank
we appreciate you being back to celebrate 50 years of FM 100.
Right.
Very good.
And we're going to be at Lafayette's.
All right. Everybody come to the party.
That's it.
Sunday, 3 o'clock.
Mike, thank you as well. Good to see
you
both.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.